Hello, I'm John Furrier with theCUBE. We are here at the new CUBE studios in New York City, the NYSE. It's theCUBE's home on the East Coast. We'll be opening up the East Coast Tech TV Silicon Valley connection with our Palo Alto studio. Of course, CUBE alumni is here. Ali Ghodsi, CEO of Databricks. Ali, great to see you in our new home here on the East Coast. We're going to bring that tech content here to Wall Street.
It's awesome, yeah, this is beautiful, amazing.
Yeah, and you were just talking to Jim Cramer, so you did a little Mad Money hit, that'll film tonight.
Yep.
Did he get into like the business side? What was he asking? What were some of his questions?
He asked about agents, you know, he's saying, are they working? And you know, I kind of pointed out that, you know, so with Agent Bricks at Databricks, what we're trying to focus on, a lot of others are focused on, you know, superintelligence, really smart AI that can solve programming Olympiad level things. We really focused on the most mundane, boring tasks that you're doing inside of an enterprise. So think of it as like the most toil things that no one wants to do. And we just want to automate those. Yeah. And that's what we're starting with. So Agent Bricks, we just focus on that. And the way we do it is instead of testing it on math Olympiad questions, we test it on, can you fill out the Salesforce entry correctly? Can you extract this data? Can you summarize this? Can you call into that system? Yeah. So very simple agents that we build with Agent Bricks, and we just evaluate them on that. And if you just focus it on these simpler tasks, you can do remarkable things. Yeah. I actually think we already have all the AGI we need for these kind of tasks. We just have to make sure that they work with high reliability.
At your summit, Data and AI Summit, one of the big themes was ease of use for developers, but also getting, you know, knowledge around the data itself. How's that going, and what are some of the results you're seeing in the field? People are talking agent to agent, a little bit out there, but some of these low-hanging fruit use cases, just get it right and accurate. Accuracy is critical. What's the progress since?
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. So there are kind of three cases, but the biggest one is these where you have a human in the loop, and we'll have a human that reviews the results. So for really important things, like, you know, something is going out to a customer, communication, or, you know, in the medical sort of field, you know, clinical trials and so on, you have a human reviewing it.
Yeah.
But there's also some of the things that we couldn't have ever a human do that we can now do automatically. I'll give you an example. AstraZeneca, they, do drug discovery, sifted through 400,000 documents with an agent. Like those 400,000, no human being could have ever done that. So no group of human beings would have been able to communicate that with each other. And that helps them actually do drug discovery faster.
Yeah.
So, you know, use cases like this, we're seeing more and more. Adidas is another one.
Yeah.
Adidas is actually now empowering their designers that make the shoes to actually directly have access to agents that have summarized the sentiment across the whole globe in different languages and what they think about the exact shoe designs that they have. And that lets them then innovate and come up with newer designs that they know will actually work in these different markets.
I was also talking with Pete Sonsini, who started at Loud Ventures, and Andy and Pete collaborated on this research, kind of like, I don't know what to call it, like more like a almost like a open source, kind of like incubator. I don't know what to call it, research.
Yeah.
Talk about the role of these kinds of research hubs that are becoming not so much applied research, but really directed.
Yeah.
And how does that affect some of the innovation? What's your vision on that?
Yeah, no, I think it's actually really important because, you know, we're seeing a lot of open source models coming out of China. And, you know, here in the US, we don't have that many. There's a few. There was one model open sourced by OpenAI. There was a few models by Meta. But I think it's fair to say that on open source, China is ahead of the United States.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what Pete and Andy are doing is excellent in that, you know, we should have domestic open source models that then lets us do innovation, do research on those. So we're big fans, big supporters of that. In general, I think the LLM layer gets more and more commoditized.
Yeah.
Either from the open source coming from China or here.
Yeah.
So I think that's good for everyone because once that layer gets commoditized, it helps the next layer, which is the applications on top.
And accelerates things.
Yeah.
I was talking to my friend John Markoff about a decade ago. He wrote a book called What the Dormouse Said. It was about the computer revolution and how the hippies and the wanted just timeshares. And it was kind of a spawned by research from the Cold War.
Yeah.
From the Russians-American Cold War and a lot of Lincoln Labs, Draper Labs, you know, Cal, UCLA, they're all working on these grants.
Yeah.
We kind of don't have that right now.
Yeah.
And we're in an AI build out.
Yeah.
And the private sector seems to be funding it.
Yeah.
And people, entrepreneurs are stepping in like Pete and Andy and others. Does that change the view of capital structures and funding? I mean, because there's a lot of big debate about this. I mean, I see it's a good thing for America.
Yeah.
NVIDIA doing a deal with Nokia. That's not Huawei.
Yeah.
That's Bell Labs, basically.
Yeah, exactly. I think we're going to see changes happening here going forward. What we're going to see is that open source Chinese models are going to disseminate. And what you're going to have is that you'll see research labs and universities using those Chinese models. And as a result, I think Western nations will say, hey, we need our own models to counter this. So I think we need more open source models. Well, private industry doesn't want open source as much because they want to monetize.
Yeah.
So as a result, what we're going to see is, I think we're going to see more and more, like we used to have it, as you said, Lawrence, you know, Livermore, Berkeley National Lab, you know, Livermore, and so on, all of these. In fact, most of the supercomputers for the last 40 years, the largest computers on the planet, were publicly funded in these kind of public company, you know, in these kind of labs, not public companies, not private companies. So I think we're going to see a resurgence of that to counterbalance the Chinese open source model.
It's kind of in a weird way, tech for good, if it depends on what lens you look at it.
Yeah.
I want to get your thoughts on the enterprise. I know you don't have a lot of time. Appreciate you taking the time on your visit to the exchange. The enterprise has been slow to adopt by some say. I don't believe the stats about failed projects. All experimentation fails at some level. But there's been definitely a focus on, hey, we can't just put AI into the enterprise.
Yeah.
As you said, there's some oil that needs to be, and brittle IT systems.
Yeah.
You guys have really nailed the data lake. You also have huge client base with OpenAIs and the Neo Clouds as data lake customers. As you have that knowledge, what's it take for the enterprise to kind of get on the fast track and get that flywheel going? What's your, what are you seeing? What are key blockers? What's the accelerant?
Yeah, I mean, look, the AI models, I think, are already powerful enough. I think we already have AGI, actually. You know, we just moved the goalpost. But if you had asked, you know, us at UC Berkeley 2009 when we were working on these things, what does AGI look like, and he showed us what we have now, we would have said, yeah, that is
That's
AGI.
It,
but now we moved the log because we don't like some of the results, and we're like, no, this is not quite. And and now we're also coming up with new names like ASI, superintelligence, and so on. But really, we have all we need.
Yeah.
What's missing then? Why are these enterprises? What's missing is, one, we need to bring the context of what's happening inside of the enterprise with proprietary information. That's not public on the web. This is, you know, how do you operate inside of a company? What are the standard operating procedures? What's the sensitive data that you have that you haven't put on the web so the large language models don't understand it? So we have to bring that context to them. And when we do that, we have to do that in a governed, careful, secured way. So I think governance and security is extremely important for any enterprise. So that's been actually our number one priority last 3 years. Because how can we give context to these LLMs with very sensitive information, while at the same time make sure that there is no leakages, that we have the lineage, that we can have an audit trail, and that we're not, you know, that we're documenting it, because there's also laws coming up everywhere, you know, everything from EU AI Act to there's going to be regulation here in the US. So I think security and governance in one sentence is the, and getting the context inside of the enterprise to the AI.
Yeah. My final question goes to CEO Ghodsi and Professor Ghodsi. If so AI factories continue to get bigger, the CapEx, enterprises adopt, and we believe there'll be a hyper-converged edge box where all protocols to all spectrum and Ethernet converge with a kind of mini AI factory box. When you have full hyper-convergence at the edge and all the systems redesigns at the superhuman level, what happens next? Because you have the keys to the kingdom looking at the data layer, because all you got to do is put like a mini factory somewhere in between.
Yeah.
What does that look like? What happens when that convergence happens at the edge?
Yeah, well, look, I think we are moving towards that future.
Yeah. But,
and are we also moving towards a future where we have quantum and so on? And are we going to have models that are so small that we can actually run them at the edge and so on? We're working towards that.
Yeah.
But honestly, the thing that keeps me up at night now is much more mundane. It's like we already have pretty smart AI. Can we just make it useful right now in the enterprise? Because right now they're not actually being used as much as they should. Like, given the capital investments and given what people are actually doing with it, there's a big difference.
Yeah.
I just want to make them applicable.
And
I think all this other stuff will happen too, and it's exciting.
Yeah, that's headroom. On the enterprise, quick follow-up on that. What would be that key thing that you would wave the magic wand right now in the enterprise? What's
it
psychology? Is it technical debt? Is it?
No, I think that they get it. It's really security and governance, making sure that you can actually,
because
you know there's a tension here.
Yeah.
This is very sensitive data. Can we give it to the large language model or can we not? Well, what happens if we give it to it? So there is a tension. And if we have enough guardrails around it, and if we can do audit tracking, and we can have the lineage and all of that, so that governance is extremely important for enterprises. That's really what we need to nail. Yeah. And then how we evaluate whether we succeeded or not.
Yeah.
Like, was I built something. Is it successful or not? Would you say, I think it's successful. Do you think the way to evaluate it is to have benchmarks and evaluations on the actual task that we're doing, not on Math Olympiad, Physics Olympiad, Humanities Last Exam is the name of the hardest exam that anyone, no one's got more than 30, 40
practical evaluation.
Yeah, can we just did you do this mundane task correctly or not? That's what we need to nail.
Yeah.
So benchmarks and evaluations on the actual tasks.
I guess Jensen was right. Agents will be the HR department. Check the evaluation.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming on our Cube
Thank
here
so
in
much.
New York City.
Yeah.
Breaking it in. Thanks for coming on, Ali Ghodsi. Making an appearance inside our new studio here at the NYSE, NYSE Wired and theCUBE partnership. Thanks for watching.